The following program is part of our 2017 Wisconsin Vote election coverage. Welcome to the 2017 State DPI Candidate Debate, a partnership production of Wisconsin Public Television and Wisconsin Public Radio. Reporting live from Madison, here's Sean Johnson and Frederica Freiberg.
Welcome. For the next hour, we will talk with the candidates running to become the superintendent of Wisconsin Public Schools.
We have the hour divided into four basic subject areas. We'll cover issues directly related to teachers, school funding, school choice, and students.
And speaking of students, our studio audience tonight is filled with them. Welcome to students from Lancaster High School in Grant County and Bayview Middle School in Green Bay. Students from Sauk Prairie High in Sauk County, as well as Madison East High, are also here. Now, several of the students have prepared questions for the candidates.
And now we welcome the candidates. Tony Evers, who has been a classroom teacher and school administrator and has served as state superintendent since 2009. Challenger Lowell Holtz has been a classroom teacher, a principal, and a school administrator. Welcome you both.
Thank you.
We want to give each candidate the opportunity to briefly, in 30 seconds or so, introduce himself to our statewide television and radio audience. So we will begin with you, Mr. Evers.
Thank you so much, and thank to both of you for being here, and for sure the students in the audience. This is quite a treat for both of us to be talking to you tonight, and of course to the people across the state of Wisconsin. So quickly, my background is really about my family. My wife I met in kindergarten many, many years ago, and actually we've been married for 44 years. We have three children who attended public schools in the state of Wisconsin, and we have six grandchildren, five of them going to public schools right here in Madison. My family is my touchstone regarding my career and my belief around this job. I've been a teacher and principal all across the state of Wisconsin, from Toma to Oakfield to Verona to Oshkosh. And for the last eight years, I've been state superintendent, and I was deputy state superintendent for the 8 years prior to that. But really, thanks to the kids here tonight. This is really a special treat for both of us.
Mr. Holtz.
Hi. I have to kind of echo a little bit what Tony said. I mean, the best part of my life is sitting kind of behind you, and she was my prom date in 1974. So we've been dating since we're 16, got married and had five kids. And we still have two kids that are at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. One's a junior, one's a senior. And we have five grandkids. And so I love kids. I spent my whole life trying to serve kids. One of my favorite jobs, and I used to tell people, if you ever want a second career, I taught third and fourth grade, and it was one of the most enjoyable things I ever did in my life, and I thought nothing would ever top that. But then I was an elementary principal, and when you see the light come on in kids' eyes and they still enjoy learning, and you know, you try to do things and they'll respond to you, I enjoyed that a lot. I've been a school district superintendent and rural areas, high poverty urban areas, and enjoyed every minute of it. And we've had success turning around failing school systems, and oftentimes we're able to do it, especially in the urban rural areas, without increasing the budget. So I'm looking forward to serving the kids across the state of Wisconsin and helping them all be successful, meeting their goals.
Before we get into our categories, we want to start by asking about some topics we know are going to come up tonight. There's news out today about a letter from the Whitnall School Board about what it calls the possible misuse of district resources for political activity during the workday by former Superintendent Lowell Holtz. So we want to ask you, Lowell Holtz, for your response.
Yes, they did a good job of talking about it on the radio today. I would typically work 10 to 12 hours per day, and I often communicated with my wife. What they have is a small handful of emails between my wife and myself before I ever decided to run for this. It was something that we were discussing in those emails. Would I run for this, or would I take a job in the, you know, another area? What were my options? And so it's, you know, you'd work for a couple hours, then I'd just send an email to my wife. We chat. I like talking to my wife. And then that's pretty much it. And so nothing illegal, because what they're talking about is illegal campaign fundraising. There is nothing illegal, and I looked at the, you know, the rules. There's nothing illegal about personal conversations on your email at work. It's when you're trying to solicit campaign funds or something like that, that's when you can get in trouble.
But you were talking about campaign organizing on your work email. Was that wrong?
I don't believe it was, because it was, I at that point had not decided to run for office. Now, you know, there are people that have been fined for doing campaign fundraising. I don't think that makes them evil. I think they made a mistake. You know, my opponent has had to pay a fine for that. But I certainly don't believe it was anything wrong. And if I did, if someone says it was, this came out months ago. Why is it coming out now? I think it was a very political act on the school board's part to try to do that. And that's unfortunate.
Tony Evers, superintendent, works a long day. Is there anything wrong with what Lowell Holtz did?
Well, I would say yes. Of course, we're in two different positions here, but Mr. Holtz used his email from work to discuss campaign issues on work time with the work email. That is, I believe that's prohibited by the elections board. I don't, you know, I wasn't there, but it's my understanding that this did happen, and I would say that's inappropriate use of the Whitnall School District server.
We want to move along to another thing.
Sure.
in this particular category, and again, this goes to you, Lowell Holtz, first. Your primary challenger said that you drafted a document, which we have a copy of here, that called for state control over the state's four largest school districts. We want to know what that's about. Why were you talking about state control over these districts? What do you want to do in those districts?
First of all, I didn't craft the document. That was a blatant lie. The document that was presented was, it was changed from what we had talked over, and it was simply, the only purpose for that entire meeting was to talk about whether we could keep, run a clean campaign so we wouldn't, you know, throw mud at each other, and whether we could work together after the primary was over. That, if you notice, that also, that meeting took place early on, and it didn't come out until after, about a week before the primary was slated, and it was a desperate act to try to put somebody down.
We're actually interested in the piece about state control or authority over these school districts in Wisconsin.
That's the last thing. If you look at my platform is not about taking over school districts. The person that made that statement, if you look at his platform, that was in his platform. He had a plan for how he would take it over.
So that's not yours?
No, I don't believe in doing that. I believe in providing support teams, encouraging innovation, those types of things. That is not mine.
Tony Evers?
Well, I think this is an issue in the campaign. We've actually chatted about this a few times already, but I do believe that the fact that this conversation took place, and to me, the issue of, well, if you get out of the race, you'll get a job and a chauffeur and all that kind of stuff, that's kind of, you know, baloney. You know, that's just not what you'd want to hear from candidates. But the issue that you bring up, Frederick, I think is a significant issue, and that is both of them had a dialogue around the possibility of having schools taken over by the state or school boards dissolved in Madison, Milwaukee, Racine, Kenosha, and Green Bay, and have schools that are underperforming turned over to charter providers or voucher providers. Well, to me, that's not how we make public policy in the state. And so I believe it was an issue that people in Wisconsin are going to have to kind of weigh.
And yet this idea of kind of school district takeovers isn't new. There was most recently the legislature mandated failing Milwaukee schools be subject to takeover. But if schools or districts are failing, why shouldn't they be kind of subject to outside intervention or authority? So both of you disagree that that should happen?
I do, and I think Lowell does too. I don't want to speak for you, Lowell. But there's no data to support that takeovers work. That's the bottom line. And so we need to be prepared as a state to support schools, to make sure that they have the adequate resources, which is one of the issues that I feel very strongly about, and make sure that the community is actively involved in turning those schools around.
The federal school improvement grant, the $3.5 billion that they spent over the last several years, the Department of Education did a study on it as the Obama administration was leaving, and they did a 413-page, something like that, report. And it said, when you do programs from outside and you impose the programs, they're doomed to failure. They spent the $3.5 billion on all these programs, and not a one showed any significant increase in closing the gaps between minorities and majority students, and none of them showed increased academic achievement. So that's one of the reasons I wouldn't be the person that would impose something from the outside in. I'm the one that would go in and work with the school districts. You know, this story has legs of its own and has too many different versions, and none of them are absolutely true. I am not someone who's going to take over schools. That's the last thing I would do. And so it's, you know, I suppose if you're running and your record is horrendous, you know, during your 8 years, you bottomed out and you're the worst state in the nation for achievement gaps and the worst state in the nation for graduation gaps, you want to divert attention from your record, and you would put it in your commercials saying something about the chauffeur. I think that's irrelevant.
Let's move on to a section of questions here about students. And we're going to ask first about Common Core. And this one's specific. We want, what's an example of how Common Core has changed the way we teach Wisconsin students? And is that good or bad? We're going to start with you, Tony Evers.
Yeah, I believe it's been a good thing. And one of the highlights of my work is working with a group of teachers of the year. We have about 30 of them in Wisconsin that I meet with regularly. And they talk about the Common Core and how it has made a difference. It's not necessarily the content, but what it allows teachers to do is to go deeper and to work on application of content. And by working on application of content, students are more engaged, they learn better, and they achieve at a higher level. So I am a supporter of the Common Core. I have been right from the beginning. But I think it has made an absolute difference in the way instruction happens in the classroom, in that it's fewer standards. Teachers are able to spend time going deeper and more thoughtful and having students reflect on their learning.
Can you get a little more specific with that? I mean, as a teacher sits down with a student now, what's something that they teach them now that would be different than when we learned math, for example?
Well,
what's an example in the classroom?
Well, I'll give you a little broader example. It's not about memorizing facts and not regurgitating facts. It's about taking those facts and applying them in real world situations. And so if it's an English language arts lesson, students work in teams and collaborate together and to solve problems that are related to a specific standard in English language arts. And actually those standards bleed into making sure that students are thinking about some social and emotional skills, the idea of collaboration, cooperation, and so on. That is a significant difference from the way instructions happened in the past. I've been to school, actually I was in a school this last week, big supporter of the Common Core, and in fact, a lot of the choice schools in Wisconsin put on their website they're supporters of the Common Core for the same reasons that I am. But five-year-old kindergarten students are able to identify what their goals are for the year, how far they've accomplished those goals, and what resources and so on that they've used. These are five-year-old kindergarten kids. That is a huge shift in the way instruction happens in our schools.
Well, same question to you. What's an example of how Common Core has changed the way we teach Wisconsin students, and is that good or bad?
Okay. Well, I'm adamantly opposed to Common Core because it hurts the kids who need the help the most. Our advanced kids could have no problems with it. The kids who really need help and struggle and need their parents to help, it hinders that process. The largest teachers' unions in the United States, like the Chicago Teachers Union, they came out absolutely against Common Core because it turns their teachers into data collectors. You know, when I talk to teachers, middle school teachers in Milwaukee, and they tell me Common Core, along with educator effectiveness, puts them in the position where they spend over an hour each and every day inputting data, and that steals time from them that they used to spend going over the informal assessments that they had during the school day with the kids, and then saying, what did you struggle with? What did you excel at? What did you struggle with? And then they'd adapt the lesson for the next day. They're spending way too much time doing that that data input. And so I don't like the idea. And I'll tell you, the other reason is, I think local control, we should have the right as local school districts to say what standards we want for our community. Every community is different. Whether you're a rural community, an urban community, everyone is a little bit different. You can't group them like that. And
what about the way that the kids learn, though, because of Common Core? I mean, is there something that you don't like about the way that teaching has changed, aside from the data entry?
It limits it. It's a set of standards that goes from A to Z. And there is no such set of standards that that's all you need to know to be successful. It's also, the way it's set up now, it's a test that can only be compared within Wisconsin. It's not, when we were kids, you would take a test, Iowa Test of Basic Skills, or whatever it was, that could be compared with our students in Wisconsin, with students in Minnesota, with every other state in the nation. I think that would be a little bit more helpful than one that's based on a program that came straight out of D.C.
I'd just jump in if I could.
Yeah, we're encouraging you both
okay,
to do
good.
So.
First of all, it didn't come from D.C. It came from experts from across the nation. In addition, it came actually from teachers and parents in Wisconsin. We all collaborated around those issues. I hesitate to suggest that the teacher effectiveness program that Lowell's talking about and the work that goes into that is connected to the Common Core, because it's not. We're conflating several different topics here. Standards are standards. That's all there is to it. It's expectations for kids. And should we have some common expectations for kids across our state? Absolutely. We have a mobile society. We have kids that move all over across this state and across this nation. So it's important to have some commonality. It doesn't restrict people from going above. I went to a school in Milwaukee this week where they've closed down all their special education classrooms. It's a full inclusion. Every student, regardless of their specifics as far as whether they have individual education plans or not, are working together, collaborating, working on the Common Core, and succeeding at really high levels. I think that it's made some significant changes.
I couldn't agree more with that, because that's exactly what we did in Peshtigo, and that's how I ended up being the Wisconsin Principal of the Year. We brought all of our special needs classes and put a special education teacher at every grade level, did heterogeneous groups, and they were extremely successful. We were able to reduce class sizes without increasing the budget at all, and the results were tremendous, and I ended up being also a national distinguished principal as a result. Last I checked, the Department of Education is in Washington, D.C., though, and the race to the top dollars, kind of, that's where I was going with that D.C. piece. Mm-hmm. You know, it came from, you know, that's where the push was coming from.
I want to move along here and ask this. Governor Walker promotes career and technical education programs to help employers fill high-demand jobs. Is that the role of K-12 education? First to you, Lowell Holtz.
I absolutely believe we need to have more career and tech ed opportunities. I've seen, especially in large school districts where kids are struggling, they need relevance and they need rigor. And the career and tech ed jobs and the career and tech ed training just excited them. You know, there were kids that stayed in school because we started an automotive program. There were kids that stayed in school because we started a culinary program. So things started to become relevant to them. There were roadblocks, you know, from the Department of Public Instruction. I mean, I testified against one of the rules that basically when the law that was recently passed that said we could hire professional craftspeople to teach in our classrooms. The law is the law, but But then the rules making authority goes with the Department of Public Instruction. And the state superintendent said, okay, but that license isn't going to be portable. Now, for a large district like Tulsa or Beloit or Milwaukee or Madison, that's fine. But most of our districts are 2,000 kids or less. And so if I wanted to have an automotive program, we would hire a teacher that would be shared between three or four school districts. And that lack of portability would basically shut it down, because where am I going to find somebody, you know, that's in their 40s or 50s, that's a master craftsperson, to move their family to Peshtigo, Wisconsin, if they can't, you know, get a full-time job?
Tony Evers, same question.
Sure. And it's a great question, because it's kind of at the core of discussions across the state of Wisconsin around what is education. There are many people that feel that education is mainly and is to have people leave the schools literate, be able to communicate well, making sure they know mathematics well and compute, and be good citizens. And I think that's great. I believe, though, that career and technical education has a huge role to play in our schools. Do we want people to be good citizens? Absolutely. We want every one of these students to be good citizens when they graduate. But we also want to have them be career and college ready. And that means that career and technical education plays a large role. We have reached out across the state of Wisconsin, and I'll bet some of the high school kids here have participated in dual enrollment opportunities, where they get college credit and high school credit at the same time. Especially with the technical college system, we've doubled the number of kids that are taking college and high school credits at the same time, primarily in the area of career and technical education. Additionally, we just received a $2 million grant from J.P. Morgan Chase, highly competitive grant because of the good work we're doing. And we're going to be putting career counselors in every region of the state to kind of work in that intersection between school and community. Sometimes I get criticized around this. I think it's really important that good citizens, career ready, we can walk and chew gum at the same time. We have to do both.
I'm going to go down to a question from one of our student audience members. Catherine, an 11th grader from Sauk Prairie High School, asks, what steps would you take to fix the achievement gaps in Milwaukee and Madison? I believe this one goes first to you, Tony Evers. Okay.
And is it Catherine?
It is Catherine.
Catherine, thanks for the question. It's a critical issue in the state of Wisconsin. We have lots of success, but I'll tell you, we have some difficulties. And it isn't necessarily an urban issue. It's all across the state. Diversity of the state is changing rapidly, and kids are coming to us not knowing the English language. So our schools are challenged around that. But I believe two things. One is there's no reason for takeovers from the state level, and I think there is no reason for interference from the federal level. This has to be solved locally. And I've worked locally with all sorts of schools across the state that are struggling. And I'll use some examples in Milwaukee. We worked with the school district to make sure that out of their hundreds of schools, that there is some consistency in the curriculum. And the mobility of students in Milwaukee, it's about an average second grader a couple years ago could go to four schools in 1 year. And if every school was different, that is going to make it extremely difficult to succeed. So we worked for them to do that. We worked with them to put into place positive behavior intervention systems that lowered their suspension and expulsion rates. But the bottom line is, for those viewers that, and I don't want to plug the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, but they had this great series of articles this last week, Time to Heal, and talked about how poverty absolutely traumatizes some children. And we need to bring a whole lot of people to the table to make that final push. Department of Children and Families, Department of Workforce Investment, putting money into job centers right in our schools. Community schools are huge. And I think it's important, not only in Madison, but in Milwaukee also, and I think across the state, where kids get mental health services, dental services, medical services, and parents are provided services to move their lives forward.
Lou Holtz?
Number one, it is not acceptable to be the worst state in the nation when it comes to achievement gaps. So you're saying, I mean, we're turning our back on generations of minority kids and saying, sorry, we didn't fix the problem. Well, every single state in the union does a better job than we do. That's not acceptable. And it's not rocket science. When you walk into the schools, and if they're not safe schools, safety, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs, safety is one of the base things we need to improve. We have to make our schools safe. When I'm sitting at a lunch with somebody and they get a text that there were a dozen fights at one of our high schools, that's not an environment that's conducive to learning. You need to be able to provide, and parents don't want to send their kids to a school like that. And he's right, poverty is terrible. It's absolutely ugly in some really condensed areas. I mean, we have parents who won't let their kids go into the front rooms of the house because bullets come through the walls. Stray bullets, but they're bullets. And we have stories of grandparents that are sitting holding their grandkids and they get shot while they're in their living room. Poverty, there's only two ways that I know of to get out of poverty. One is education and one is crime. It's not a coincidence that we have the highest African-American incarceration rate in the nation. It's because it's directly correlated to our failure to educate our kids. It can be done. We've brought safety back to, you know, there's 20 large school districts in Wisconsin. Beloit is one of them. We were able to bring back safety to the hallways. We were able to talk to the teachers, talk to the community, raise expectations. We did it as a team. So everybody had a piece of writing the plan. And as a result, you know, we said to the teachers, what do you need to be successful with the kids? And they said, you need to give us time to do what we do best, which is teach. And so that was our motto. If a kid had his head down on the desk, I guaranteed him once every period of the day, I'd have an administrator walk through. What the bottom line is this recently, the African-American graduation rate in Milwaukee was 56%. In Madison, it was worse, it's 54%. Beloit was still pushing the high 80s. And it's not because the African-American kids are smarter in Beloit, it's because we put a system in place where they could be successful. We need to do that for all of our schools.
Now, this is a topic that we could have spent an hour or two sure. or five on, but instead, we're gonna move along. And our next topic is school choice. So this begins with another question from one of our students. 10th grade student Annie from Madison High School asks, if school choice is designed to allow students to leave failing schools for state-funded private schools, quote, why is not the solution to increase funding to public schools in order to raise the quality of education for all students? So that is her question, and I will send that first to you, Tony Evers, I guess because you spoke last.
That's fine. And Annie, you're right on. That is a great question. I've been around long enough to watch 26 years of choice schools in Milwaukee. And for the most part, and I know there's studies that'll show one thing or the other, but I look at results, and results for 26 years, it's not a discernible difference between our choice schools and our public schools. And indeed, as the program has expanded across the state, I'll just put it this way: there's an X number of dollars available for our schools. There's not an unlimited amount. I'm glad I'm working with the governor on this one. We're going to get some more money for our schools. But the bottom line is, there's a limited amount of money, and if we support two systems, that makes it more difficult for all schools. I prefer that choice schools have the same accountability system as the regular public schools. I think that's critical, and I also believe that our first constitutional priority is to fund adequately our public schools. And in addition, Frederica, the thing that a lot of people don't know is there isn't this like mass exodus from public schools to go to choice schools. Many of the kids are already there. In fact, the last rendition of choice was to allow it to go further out state, and over 70% of the students were already in choice schools. They did not, and so that essentially we're subsidizing public and private education.
Well, Holtz, what
about
that?
And parochial education.
Well, first, there was a recent research article done in the National Review, and it said, it was titled Apples to Apples, and they were able to do a direct comparison between the schools because they are taking the same test, and they were able to, align the kids and say what the different poverty levels were, what their achievement was. And what they did find was that the choice and voucher schools did much better than the public schools. And that's unfortunate, and that's what we need to fix. I've seen firsthand, my dad was an inner city pastor, and he had one of the first voucher schools in Milwaukee. And when I saw that, the first thing and I was a public school principal at the time, but I saw the light in the eyes and the excitement in the parents and the involvement and the success that they were having. And so I called Dr. Fuller up, who I had met previously in my doctoral studies. And Howard Fuller had been the superintendent of Milwaukee Public Schools. And I asked him, why, as a public school superintendent, would you support vouchers? And he said, in Milwaukee, we have some of the best schools in the nation. He said, but we also have some of the absolutely worst schools in the nation. And he said, I don't like the idea of forcing a parent to send her child or his child to a school where that they're going to fail. He said, so from his perspective, it's a civil rights issue that we should have voucher opportunities. Now, the money doesn't go, the money has to follow the child, because it would be unconstitutional if it was giving money to a parochial school or a private school. And I like the idea of parents having choices. It holds us as public schools accountable. I was never afraid of competition. It made us better. Whether we were in northeastern Wisconsin in the Peshtigo-Marinette area, or in Beloit where you have 2,400 kids in a high school, competition doesn't hurt. It gives parents options, because not every kid does 2,400 kids in high school well, and they need different choices. So it's, I believe the one place that Tony is right is that vouchers and choice schools will never, be able to serve all of our kids. The mass majority of our kids are served in our public schools, and so we need to focus on making them better. Does more money make them better? No, that also has been shown over and over again that you don't need more money to improve. You can improve, like I said, in Peshtigo, by staying within the budget. And it's a matter of being focused and being determined and doing what's best for our kids. And we can do that. And good question, Annie, by the way.
I was just going to say, the byproduct of this discussion of choice is that we are not getting adequate resources, period. And I know that we're going to go there.
Yeah, we're going to talk about funding.
That is a major issue for us.
Thank you.
We'll pause our group discussion here at the halfway mark, because we asked each candidate to bring a question to ask directly of his opponent. Lowell Holtz, go ahead with your question for Tony Evers.
Okay. In your first 8 years, we bottomed out and became the worst state in the nation for achievement and graduation gaps. Mm-hmm. Why did you let that happen?
That's a great question. I didn't let that happen, Lowell. And as you know, the achievement gap in the state is absolutely tied to poverty. And for those of you who have read the Time to Heal program in the Journal Sentinel, talked about industry well-paying jobs leaving Milwaukee. We've all heard the story. Well-paying jobs leaving a city that was relatively destitute as it relates to poverty. Poverty has a significant impact on the way kids learn. Did I cause that poverty? Absolutely not. But I will tell you that we have worked hard with Milwaukee Public Schools, as I indicated before, to turn that around. I didn't let it happen. It was caused by external things. But the bottom line is, we have not been just sitting around doing nothing. We've been working very hard with Milwaukee. A small example, huge for Milwaukee. We worked with them to allow them to have their high school start earlier in the school year, actually go around the school start date, which is a huge issue across the state of Wisconsin, and allowed them to next year have a June credit recovery time for all their high school kids. So that my response is, we have not let it just sit there, as you tried to allude to. We spent a lot of time, effort, and money doing the exact same things that you have talked about being effective. Now, my question for you, Lowell, is this, and it's a more personal one and, frankly, a more friendly one, because I am a glass half full person. Campaigns are really difficult. And I know you have talked glowingly about your family, just as I have. Just tell me what, how the campaign has impacted your kids and your family. Has it been positive? Are they excited about it? Are they, you know, every turn of the dime, they're concerned about it? So how, I mean, I can talk about my family, how it's impacted. I'm just curious how it has impacted your kids and your wife and others that love you.
That was really nice of you to ask that. Yeah. It's been a really tough journey for my wife to hear the negative attack ads. Mm-hmm. And it really, even though you know it's not true, you know there's half-truths, there's innuendos, and because we're close to Madison, we get lots of coverage. And you know, if we lived up in Stevens Point, we might not hear it as much. But it's been extremely tough. You know, that it's unfortunate that that's what happens in politics today.
Yeah.
Because it, you know, I've been doing this for 30 years. I've been a cop. I'm used to taking a hit or two. It, you know, and I figured I would. But it's really hard on the people you love.
Yeah.
Now my kids, they're a little tougher.
Yeah.
Not that my wife's not tough. She's just, but my kids, I don't know if they grew up in a different era. They're used to that debate
back
between
and
conservative and liberal, and you know, but when you get right down to it, you and I both know when it comes to kids, they don't care if you're conservative or liberal, a Democrat,
right,
or Republican. They care whether you care about them and whether you love them.
Yeah.
So,
good.
Yeah, good question.
Thank you.
All right, thank you both. We now move on to the topic of school funding. The legislators this week, as you know, are giving the budget a hard look. The governor's proposed budget seeks a nearly $650 million increase in K-12 funding over 2 years. There is a chance, however, as you also both know, that Republicans in the legislature may not go for that amount. What would you say to state legislators who are writing this budget? First to you, Tony Evers.
I was talking to him last night at 8 o'clock at night,
yeah,
actually. Yes, I would. I propose a budget, as I do every biennium, to the governor and his staff back in November. I asked for $700 million increase, which on the surface, that like, oh my gosh, $700 million. But it's to me, it was rather closer to inflation. And then towards the end, before the governor released his budget, he actually gave me a call and said, oh, by the way, you're going to like this budget. And we've included a lot of things that were in your budget. $650 million, but even equally important issues around mental health were put in that budget and a significant increase, and also some help around rural schools. So I absolutely believe resources do matter. I know we can look at different studies that says don't, different studies that says it does, but the fact of the matter is, in three of the last presidents that have had kids in school, elementary and secondary school, paid an average of $38,000 per kid for tuition. Money matters. Matters to the presidents, it matters to me as state superintendent. We're looking at $12,000 per kid in the public schools. I think it makes a significant difference. Our state, for various reasons, has not stepped up to the plate over the last several years. And as a result of that, we've had enormous numbers of referenda passed across the state. Actually, and there's going to be another go through this April. So people of the state, Republicans or Democrats, it doesn't make any difference. 600,000 people over the last two general elections have voted to raise their own taxes to support their public schools. That is a significant thing.
And we want to talk about that in a moment,
okay,
in a separate question, but let me ask the question about what you would say to state legislators who are writing this budget as it pertains to K-12 funding.
Well, as you know, every time the governor, whoever the governor is, proposes a budget, it then goes through the joint finance process. And I don't know how many of you have had the opportunity, especially your kids, when you do get the opportunity, you should attend one, because it's really quite moving, because people come and plead their cause to the joint finance. And the people that sit on joint finance are incredibly patient. I mean, there are hours and hours and hours of people coming and saying, this is why we need funding. Schools are always at the top of the list. I am proud that our governor recognized that, you know, the people across Wisconsin are willing to support schools. They'd like to support successful schools. What I believe is that it'll end up, it never comes out of joint finance exactly like it went in. Do I advocate for our schools? I would always advocate for our public schools. Whatever comes out, we're going to make it work, irregardless of whatever it is. And if I talk to legislators on a regular basis, including last night in Menominee Falls. So are there opportunities to provide better opportunities for our kids? Can we spend our money in better ways? I wanna see the money go to the classrooms, not administration. I wanna see money going directly to things that are gonna impact the kids. You know, the more teachers, smaller class sizes, making sure our teachers get, at least cost of living, if not, recognition for the good work they do. So that's where I kind of come out across on the budget.
Can I just ask, you both said some nice things about the governor's budget, but you've got the legislature on the phone right now. I know budgets are very complicated,
sure,
but they want a yes or no on that money.
Yes.
You're a yes.
Yes.
The $200 per student?
$650.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And I do like that it's targeted in certain ways, so I would always support the governor's budget.
Yeah, and just to interrupt just for a second, to make it clear, 90% of most governor's budgets are passed, and so the time to advocate is absolutely right now.
Move on to another piece of the governor's budget here. The governor's budget also includes a so-called Act 10 provision that would require employees to pay 12% of their health care costs in order for schools to get that increased aid. Madison East High 10th grader Ariel wants to know whether you support this. And I think we'll go to you first,
sure.
Tony Evers.
And I spent probably an hour and a half of my 2 hours last night talking to the Joint Finance Committee about that exact thing. I think it's a significant overreach on the part of the state to say you need to be compliant for something that, frankly, under present law doesn't exist. So basically what the request is to change law to say this is something that school districts have to be compliant about. So how do we make a judgment whether it's copay, whether it's a deductible, whether it's actually people paying for part of the premium? That's impossible to kind of sort through. I think it's going to be a mess, and clearly I know people at Madison School District are very concerned about this. School districts have cut back, obviously, because A, the state hasn't kind of kept up with their end of the bargain, but B, the cost of health insurance has begun to be shared across the state of Wisconsin. I think, and I sense the committee was feeling the same way, it seems like something very impossible to implement to begin with, I'm speaking for myself here, it's a significant issue of overreach by the state to kind of intervene between school districts and their employees. I think it's a step in the wrong direction and almost impossible to implement.
Loholtz, where do you stand on that?
Ariel, thanks for the question. An example I have is, despite rumors to the contrary, I'm a very good driver. I've taken emergency driving classes, pursuit driving classes when I was a police officer, and when I see the speed limit sign in front of my house that says 25, I'm very comfortable doing 45 or 50. However, if I do 45 or 50, I also know that dollars to donuts, although that's an old saying because donuts cost more than a dollar now.
Yeah.
But you can pretty much bet that I'll get stopped and I'll get a ticket. Act 10, well, the part of where he's talking about the law is the enforcement piece. And I think the governor's pointing out that Act 10 is still the law of the land. And you might not like it, but that doesn't mean you don't have to follow it. Now, as a school district superintendent, especially when Act 10 first kicked in and we needed to comply with things like that, we made sure we did adjustments in different ways so our teachers weren't taking hits, because teachers are very important to us. And matter of fact, they're the ones that are gonna, if a kid's achievement rate is ever gonna change, it's not because something I as a superintendent did or something I as a principal would have done. It's because they're going to be engaged by that teacher. And so it's incumbent on us to provide the best atmosphere for the kids. Do I think they can comply? I think the school districts, if they get creative, should have no problems. This shouldn't be an issue. It obviously is for some, but I don't think it should be.
Yeah. And I just have to interject for a second. Under present law, There is no requirement for school districts to do this. This is going to be a change in law to make this requirement. To me, it just kind of rehashes the whole Act 10 thing. I believe Act 10 had a significant issue. I opposed it right from the beginning, but it has a significant issue around morale in the state. I just don't think it's a place to go, and I don't think it's a thing to be implemented. And frankly, changing the law to now kind of retroactively say, gotcha, that doesn't work for me.
This leads us right into our next topic, which is about teachers. And it begins with a student question. Eighth grade student Nathan from Bayview Middle School in Green Bay asked this: how do you plan on attracting high school and college students to the teaching career path? And we'll go to you, Lowell Holt.
Well, thank you. Mm-hmm. Nathan, I like that question because right now, unfortunately, we're losing way too many excellent teachers. We're losing them for any number of reasons, but a lot of the reasons I've heard are, number one, the time that's stolen from them from their classroom. You know, with the data entry, the checklists, you know, the checklists that they're required to do on their students. You know, those types of things frustrate teachers because it takes time away from them. When I hear the investigative reports done out of the city of Milwaukee where teachers are being pushed around, shoved, hit, and nothing is being done to help them, they're in an environment where not only is it not safe for the kids, it's not safe for them. We can retain teachers by giving them an environment, which is why I did a Teacher's Bill of Rights, because every teacher deserves to be in a safe classroom and a safe school. Every kid deserves to be in a safe classroom and a safe school. We need to return discipline, character education to our kids, especially in all of our schools. So when teachers are enjoying what they're doing, think of the times when you visited schools and you walk into a classroom and the kids are having fun. The teacher is engaged, you know, and the teacher is having fun teaching the kids. The kids reflect how the teacher feels. If a kid sees a teacher, you know, not feeling well, being depressed because they're having to do all these other things, they're not going to want to be a teacher. If they see people not respecting the teachers, they're not going to want to be a teacher. But if they see the teacher respected and valued and enjoying themselves while they're teaching the class, the kids are going to say, I'd like to be a teacher too. And that's how we're going to attract kids to the teaching profession.
Tony Evers, to Nathan's question, how do you plan to attract students into the teaching
profession.
Career?
Yes, absolutely. Nathan, that's wonderful. That's one of the, I hope it doesn't keep you up at night, but it keeps me up at night. It's a huge issue for our state. We have, under very different circumstances, but I suggest Act 10 began when we, in order to pass that act, we needed to kind of pit people against each other, and teachers were a target. And I hear that when I go, I'm on the Board of Regents of the University of Wisconsin system. I visit all sorts of campuses. And I haven't found many young people that want to become a teacher. And when I ask why, they talk about not wanting to enter a profession where they have a target on their back. That's not where we want our teachers to go. And frankly, that's free. All we have to do is stop disrespecting the profession. And I think as policymakers, we can pull that off. We just have to be a little more disciplined in the way we talk. But in addition, as far as there are some really interesting things. We have worked real hard in many school districts. I'll use my home school district of Plymouth, where they have collaborated with the UW system campus to offer education 101 right in Plymouth High School. So kids that are interested in the profession can get a feel for that and move that forward. We lost not a generation, but I'd say a whole bunch of young people from the ages of 20 to 24 that don't want to become teachers. We have to, and I'm afraid we're not going to get them back. So we have to work locally and at the high school level to encourage young people to get into the profession. Pewaukee is a good example where they actually have a teacher career preparation program where young people, juniors and seniors, are working with mentors in the classroom. And hopefully some of those young people, I visited them this week, I'd say 3/4 said they wanted to become teachers. So we're going to hold them to it. But we have to start at the high school level. It's really critical.
The governor's budget proposes a lifetime teacher license instead of requiring teachers to renew every 5 years. Is this a good idea, Lowell Holtz?
Some of the best teachers I had when I was a principal had lifetime licenses. and they did outstanding jobs, and they were leaders in our faculty. I think it's a great idea, and it's one I hope comes to fruition. As the instructional leaders, as the local community setting their standards, if they want their teachers to have additional training in specific areas, you know, I think that's the way to target the training, not say you need to, when I was recertifying, I have to get 6 credits every 5 years. I can have 6 credits in just about anything. I think the life license is a good idea because teachers aren't always, you know, focused then on the recertification process. They're focused on improving themselves as a teacher. And teachers love to be able to pick their staff development because they see what they need, and we as administrators need to listen to what that is. So I'm a very supportive person for that lifetime license.
Tony? Yeah, it's a great question because I've asked it probably to 2,000 teachers or more campaigning this year. Mixed answers, I'll tell you that. There are people that are thinking, so what's the trap door here? What are we missing? Because their lack of trust about the political system. But I think there is two things that we have to focus on. One is relicensing really has compelled people to have continuous improvement and have professional development. It causes it to happen. Now, can that happen without every 5-year license? I believe so. But we cannot tell our parents and our students, frankly, and community members that professional development and continuous improvement don't matter. That would be a horrible mistake. So as we kind of think through this, we have to put some pieces in place to make sure that it's done in a way that people feel confident that the high-quality professional development is in place.
I want to ask a question that's kind of outside these topic areas, but we want to get your quick take on it. A bill introduced this week in the legislature would create a basic gun license that, according to the NRA, will allow parents to pick up and drop off their children from school without having to leave their firearm at home. What's your position on that bill, very quickly?
Was that the Senator Craig bill? I don't have a problem with parents who are law-abiding citizens who have a concealed carry permit, which is the law. For them, it's what if they forget and now they're lawbreakers? You know, I don't see a problem with them picking up or dropping off their kids. We had an issue like that in a school district where a mom called up grandpa and said, could you pick up your granddaughter because I'm tied up at work, I can't get there. And he said, sure, I'm just a couple blocks away. And it led to some really hard feelings because the grandfather forgot. He mm-hmm. didn't do anything on purpose.
Tony Evers, your position on that bill?
I'm against it.
Why?
Because I think the more guns in schools, around schools, is not going to increase safety.
All right, we leave it there. Thank you. Finally tonight, and we are to that point, 1-minute closing statements. A coin toss before the program determined that Lowell Holtz will make his closing remarks first. So,
first of all, and especially the students and the teachers and you guys, thanks for letting us be here and to the listening audience. We have a lot of challenges in the state of Wisconsin, and I know we can do better. I don't accept the fact that we have the worst achievement gaps or worst graduation gaps in the nation for several consecutive years. It's not acceptable. I mean, there's high poverty in every other state in the nation. You can't just blame it on high poverty. It's something that has to be resolved. We can't keep turning our back on generations of minority kids. I mean, let's call it what it is. Across the entire state, we have less than 40% of our kids proficient, according to the national assessment, in reading and math at fourth and eighth grade level. We have to do better. We're failing way too many kids, and I know we can do it. We have outstanding teachers in this state. We have outstanding parents. We have intelligent kids. We just have to raise the bar and get it done because it's our future and it's their future.
And Tony Evers has the final closing statement.
Well, thanks so much for both of you to be here, and especially the students that are here and their teachers. I am, and I will continue to be, a glass half full person. And I think we've had some really significant improvements over the last 8 years I've been state superintendent, whether it's the decreases in the number of suspensions and expulsions, the number of kids going into career and technical education programs has risen. And we're having some great success actually in some of our most struggling schools and moving the needle forward. I think my main job, anybody's main job in this position, is to be an advocate for 860,000 kids. That is my main job. I know you're all voting in a few days, but my main job is to make sure that those kids get a great education. I've seen numerous successes across the state of Wisconsin, whether I'm in Milwaukee or Osceola or Levi Strom. We have great things going on in our school, and we have to build upon that. Do we have to take on those challenges? Absolutely, we need to take on those challenges. That is a really important thing, but we have to move from our successes to make sure that happens.
Thank you to both the candidates. That's all for tonight's debate. You can find the debate posted at wisconsinvote.org. I'm Sean Johnson of Wisconsin Public Radio.
Also look for election coverage next week on Here and Now and on Wisconsin Public Radio. I'm Frederica Freiberg. And we asked the students in the audience to hold their applause until the end, and they got an A on that. But now, you may applaud.
For more 2017 election coverage, go to wisconsinvote.org.